And so now we're going to throw it over to you, Adam.
Thank you, Marissa and Rachel, who have been conducting our live video interviews in the back. And good morning and welcome to everybody who's assembled for this truly momentous occasion at the University of Rhode Island and at the Harrington School of Communication and Media. When I was walking in the tent this morning, Ryan Carrillo from Campus and Space Planning said to me, "Boy, Adam, this really is one of the best schools of communication and media in the country because you must have a direct relationship to God to get the weather to turn out like it has today." It was just under 1 year ago that many of you who are here today also assembled on this very same location for a wall-breaking ceremony, during which we promised to turn the 103-year-old Ranger Hall building behind us into a state-of-the-art communication and media hub that would rival any facility in the country. And we are extremely excited and proud to show you what we've done with the place to turn it into the new Harrington Hub for global leadership in communication and media. This is a state-of-the-art facility, and when you tour it after this event, you're going to see cutting-edge film screening room, active learning classrooms, media equipment center, digital innovation lab, collaborative editing suites. But at the same time, there are several things that you won't necessarily notice right away. That's everything we've done to make sure this building can stand strong
100 years, and you also want everything that we've done to prepare this building for phase two, so we can expand it in the near future to the upper floors, and we're going to need all help and support to do that. And as a matter of fact, we also want your advice in terms of cutting-edge learning spaces and teaching environments for our faculty and our students. And if you visit our microsite for this event, link through harrington.uri.edu, there is in fact a survey there that you can take, and you can let us know exactly what you think we should do with that space. You also won't see the work of dozens of faculty to help to design and plan the facility that you're going to tour. And you won't see the many dozens of faculty and students and staff and Harrington School Advisory Board members who have helped to plan this event today and the public relations campaign leading up to it. And lastly, you won't see a lot of the wiring that's been built into the walls of this facility, wiring that will allow the facility to be flexible and adaptable and nimble for the future, because as communication and media technologies evolve at a rapid pace, we've equipped this facility in such a way that we can instantly upgrade it with the newest equipment whenever it's needed so that it will never go out of date. But this is more than a celebration of just a building, though. A structure, of course, like this is really only as important as the people who occupy it. And our 65 full-time faculty in the Harrington School and over 100 professional instructors are the true foundation of this school. And our 1,500 students who are studying communications, public relations, film media, journalism, writing and rhetoric, and library and information studies are the lifeblood of our community. Together, the relationships that they form, the knowledge that they produce, and that the deeds they will accomplish in this facility are what will truly make this building a home to the Harrington School. So in essence, this is a celebration more of people than anything else, and of the possibilities that emerge when we give people facilities like the Harrington Hub to work in. The building is just a means to an end, a way of facilitating the cutting edge research and global communication products for which we have become so well known. At the Harrington School, we like to say we're not just studying and examining the global future of communication and media, we are actively creating that future here as we become a true global leader in communication and media research and education. And we hope you'll share this message with your friends and your followers online by posting today. We'll be live tweeting using the hashtag Harrington Hub. So please let the world know that you are here helping us to make history. Tell them as well how delighted we are to welcome so many distinguished guests, members of our federal delegation, Senator Sheldon Whitehouse and Jack Reed, Congressman James Langevin and David Cicilline, Lara Salomano, Chief Marketing Officer for the state of Rhode Island from the Rhode Island Commerce Department, Representative Carol Hagan McIntyre, and Representative Carlos Toban, Board of Education Chair Barbara Cottom, and Timothy Del Judas, Board of Education Member. Also welcoming Steven Feinberg, Executive Director for the Rhode Island Film and TV Office, Liz Gledhill from the South Kingston Town Council, Richard Culotta, Chief Information Officer for the state of Rhode Island, many of our elected officials from around the state, members of the press, and many members of our Harrington School Executive Advisory Board representing companies ranging from CBS and NBC Universal to IBM and Thomson Reuters and HBO and Fidelity and Citizens Bank and corporate partners from all around the country. I'd also especially like to welcome one of our distinguished Harrington School Executive Advisory Board members, Adam Weiner, class of 87, who will tomorrow night be receiving the College of Arts and Sciences 2016 Distinguished Achievement Award. Also in attendance today is Robert Vincent, class of 75, Executive Vice President at IGT, last year's recipient of the College of Arts and Sciences Distinguished Achievement Award, and this year representing IGT, which will receive the President's Corporate Distinguished Achievement Award. A special thanks to my newest friend and member of the Harrington School Executive Advisory Board, Ms. Meredith Vieira. Meredith is a Rhode Island native, Emmy-winning TV journalist and personality, and someone who has been so incredibly gracious to join us here today and who has hosted over 75 of our students on the set of her shows in New York City. And as a result of that, she has decided to come here today because I think she wants to meet more of these students as well. There's one board member and graduate of URI in the Harrington School who tried really hard to be here today and just couldn't pull it off. But she asked if I would be willing to show a message from her because she is so excited to celebrate this event with us. Ms. Christiane Amanpour.
Chief International Correspondent for CNN, and a proud graduate of the Harrington School and the University of Rhode Island, I'm really thrilled to see this multi-million dollar investment into state-of-the-art learning spaces that will help Harrington School teach students all the knowledge and skills they'll need to be successful in their chosen profession. From a film screening room and digital innovation lab to cutting-edge classrooms and digital editing suites, the Harrington Hub will foster global leaders in communication and media at a time of urgent need. So congratulations to everyone in the Harrington School for reaching this important milestone.
Christiane is a strong advocate of the Harrington School. She counsels us on our curriculum. She has funded a large endowment to begin the annual Amanpour Lecture in International Journalism, which we will be celebrating the 10th year of this year. And she has also been tweeting about this event because she's so excited and wishes she could be here with us. Another strong advocate of the Harrington School, who fortunately is here with us today, is President David M. Dooley. We are incredibly appreciative to have such a fantastic and visionary leader like Dr. Dooley, who's been incredibly supportive of the Harrington School and realizes our aspirations to be a true global leader in communication and media education. And we welcome your thoughts, President Dooley, on what this facility will mean for URI.
Thank you, Adam, and thanks to all of you for joining us today for the next transformational moment in the development of the University of Rhode Island. I want to begin by thanking two individuals who really made this all possible today, one of which, of course, is Dick Harrington. And his vision, his passion, the compelling energy that he brought to the University of Rhode Island to make sure that this institution was prepared to be a leader in communications in the 21st century. The other individual is my former, my current colleague, the former president of the University of Rhode Island, Robert Carruthers, who had those early conversations with Dick, who was instrumental in the gift that Dick gave to the University of Rhode Island to make the Harrington School possible. And Bob, I just want to thank you for your vision and your energy in making this happen. Those of you who know me know that I'm a scientist, a chemist to be precise, and I'm a big advocate for the sciences, technology, engineering here at the University of Rhode Island. All of those are disciplines which are fundamentally foundational and important in the 21st century. And I've spent a lot of time promoting each and every one of them, and I'm busy doing that again this November as we look ahead into another election with money on the table for the University of Rhode Island and its advanced facilities for the College of Engineering and to create an innovation campus affiliated with the University of Rhode Island. So I'll urge you all, you've seen the signs, vote yes on question four. But here's the point of that. These are all critical 21st century disciplines, the entire STEM arena. But I will say this, the most critical 21st century discipline of them all, in my judgment, is communications. Because we now live and what Thomas Friedman would call, a hyper-connected world, where the ability to communicate across previously large divides of space and time have become critical, not just to the well-being of the planet, but to the survival of the planet. Just two things to emphasize that. I learned this, and it really dawned on me several years ago, when it became clear that a single obscure journalist publishing a single image in a small Danish publication could have worldwide consequences in a matter of hours, as that image of Muhammad lit up the globe. That was inconceivable 25 years ago, maybe even 20 years ago, but it's what global communications means now. The other thought is much more recent. When the whole globe literally lit up in seconds, when a candidate for the presidency of the United States refused to commit to honoring the outcome of an American presidential election. the whole world noticed. It's not just America that is now in suspense. The entire connected world is now in suspense, wondering what the ramifications of that statement might be and what it even means. Again, inconceivable, even 10 years ago, when already the presidential elections in the United States received global attention. They've received global attention for decades, but not like this. And it reminds us all that the ability to communicate across historical, cultural, language, socioeconomic, and other kinds of barriers and divides has never been more critical to the future of America and to the future of the world. And what we aim to do in the Harrington School of Communication and Media is produce the professionals who will guide and lead and contribute to new developments in the world of global communications, who will have the skills, the cultural understandings, the perspectives, the detailed knowledge to not just facilitate communications, but to lead in the development of new means and modes of communication, to translate things about what they mean into the appropriate cultural and local context, to frame messages that will go global in a matter of seconds so that the meaning is clear and concise. Those skills are ever more important, and what we aim to do at the University of Rhode Island in the Harrington School of Communication and Media is to do the research, to do the teaching, to prepare the next generation of experts and leaders in these fields to make the world a better, safer, more prosperous, and healthier place than it is today. That's our vision for the Harrington School of Communications, and that's why I believe it's one of the most important things the University of Rhode Island can and will do, and we're here to celebrate a very critical and indeed transformational step in that process today. It's also my privilege and honor to share with you the fact, as you've already heard, that all four members of the federal delegation from the state of Rhode Island are with us today. That in and of itself sends a very powerful message of the importance of today and of communications to these already global leaders. They understand very, very well what we're trying to do and will do and its importance. And frankly, our success here at the University of Rhode Island in many, many ways has depended upon their support, their enthusiasm for our vision and goals, their constant guidance and even mentoring as we pursue those goals, and their willingness to advocate for public higher education and for the University of Rhode Island in particular on all kinds of stages, from local to global. Senator Jack Reed has been an individual that we've looked to for many, many years, that has been a great colleague of the University of Rhode Island for a long time, a great colleague of me personally for a long time. I've enjoyed working with Senator Reed on a whole host of projects. He's made a profound difference. He's one of the Senate's most distinguished members and a leader in that body and a leader globally. And Senator Reed, we're delighted to welcome you to the stage.
Well, thank you, Mr. President, for that very kind introduction and for your extraordinary leadership here at the University of Rhode Island. I've got to love a place that's motto is think big. For obvious reasons, I've been trying to think big all my life, and we are simpatico, ladies and gentlemen. I want to particularly recognize my colleagues in government, particularly Senator Whitehouse, Congressman Langer, and Congressman Cicilline. We work collectively and collegially for the benefit of the university. If something is accomplished, it's accomplished because of all of us, not one of us. So thank you very much, my colleagues. Let me also commend the university for this great moment we're celebrating with the Harrington Hub, President Dooley and Dean Brownwell, Director Roth, and particularly Dick Harrington. Thank you, and all the members of the community. The Hub will put critical tools in the hands of students so they can begin to master this emerging and absolutely critical technology that has swept the world. And the president has done a very good job of describing its incredible impact. We now have widespread access of information instantaneously worldwide. It has literally democratized this technology, the creation of content, the development of knowledge, and how we interact and do everything. It's made us easier, though, on the other side of the equation to indulge a very human tendency, that is to reinforce what we believe in, not to question what we're doing. And one of the key goals and one of the key challenges of this school is to prepare journalists, media specialists that not only reinforce what they believe, but question and allow us to question, because it's through this questioning that we truly make progress. And the Harrington School is at the forefront of this effort, preparing these professionals who understand technology, both its benefits and also its potential shortcomings. This is essential, as the President said, to our future in every dimension. So I applaud what is being done today. I salute you. It's on the cutting edge. I want to congratulate the university and all part of it, and thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Senator Reid, for those comments. And I could not agree more that one of the most important outcomes of what the Harrington School will do is to prepare people in the communications fields that communicate facts and question and drive towards the truth of any situation to serve all the people. And that is ever more critical, whereas you so, I think, correctly pointed out, Senator Reid, we all have the opportunity now to live in our own bubble, where the only information we need receive is the information that already reinforces every bias and conviction we already have, and we need not listen to anything that's in conflict with our values or views, and nothing in this hyper-connected world could be more dangerous than that. And that's one of the things that we'll tackle in the Harrington School of Communications with our students. Senator Sheldon Whitehouse has also been a great friend, a great contributor to the success of the University of Rhode Island. I'm delighted to say he and I will share an opportunity in Austin, Texas, coming up in November at a session entitled at the National Meeting of the Association of Public and Land Grant Universities of What the Next Administration Needs to Know. And that's going to be a very, very important moment as well, and we're delighted to have Senator Whitehouse participating in that. And that's just one small example of the kind of commitment that he's made to advancing the University of Rhode Island and our agenda. Senator Whitehouse.
Thank you, David, and welcome everyone. It is a true honor for me to join Senator Reid, Congressman Cicilline, and Congressman Langevin in welcoming this new arrival on URI's campus. We are delighted to have Meredith Vieira back amongst us, a great Rhode Islander. And I want to join everyone in saluting both the leadership and the vision and the generosity of Dick Harrington in making all of this come true. URI is doing exciting things. The new Beaupré Chemistry Building has just been launched. Two cyber centers of excellence, thanks to Congressman Langevin, have been launched. A new plan for your exciting graduate school of oceanography is underway. And yes, we need to vote yes on four to make sure that more of those good things happen. But what I would like to say is that I grew up at a time when Wonder Bread and TV dinners and canned vegetables were the standard diet, and health food, you had to go across town to a strange place where you probably had to be a member even to buy any. I grew up at a time when rivers like the Cuyahoga River in Ohio caught fire because of the amount of pollution. We have taken big leaps. We have gone very much from junk food to health food. And we have gone very much from pollution to responsibility for our environment. In our communications environment, too often we are still in the junk food and pollution era. And I look forward to the Harrington School of Communication helping to lead us through that social change so that the communications diet of the average American is healthy, informative, and supports our country's progress. Thank you very much.
Senator Whitehouse, I just really have no idea what you might be referring to when you talk about junk food and pollution in the communications environment of the 21st century in America. I'll ask you after our event today. It's my privilege and honor to introduce next Congressman James Langevin. We're in his district, and he has been a great advocate for the University of Rhode Island in his many terms in Congress. As the senator mentioned, he's one of Congress's leaders in the realm of cybersecurity, and his interest in that has paid great dividends for the institution and for others here in Rhode Island and indeed in America and across the world. That's just one small way in which Congressman Langevin has contributed to the well-being of all of us and particularly to this institution. Welcome, Congressman Langevin.
Thank you very much for the introduction. It's an honor to be with you today. And I want to take this opportunity to congratulate you and the university on this this outstanding facility.
I know that
the mic here. Okay. Obviously, this as the world has become more and more interconnected and digital, I know this will help the Harrington School maintain its position as a worldwide leader in public relations. Well, certainly an honor to be with my colleagues in government, with Senator Whitehouse, Congressman Cicilline, and. By the way, just to underscore what a big deal this is, I gave Cicilline a day pass to come over all the way from the first district to be here. So, David, welcome. Let me also, of course, recognize the Harrington School Director, Adam Roth, and Dean Brownwell, and of course, Rhode Island's own Meredith Vieira. Meredith, we're glad that you remember your home state and could come here today. Your presence speaks volumes, so thank you for that. Well, this, you are across the globe. Can you do the virus? I'll just hold on. Say that this new hub will allow URI students to connect with their peers across the globe, helping to further the Harrington School and our state as a whole, as a focal point of global communication studies. As more and more of our communication, certainly the value of digital literacy skills will only increase. And obviously, the world has seen so many different changes, and each day will be absolutely central going forward. So while it's tempting to see the future in terms of programming or software, the digital communication skills are certainly just as important. We live in a more interconnected global society than ever before, with colleagues in other states, in other countries, and in fact, other continents. And the Harrington School's graduates are Rhode Island's future leaders, who will help attract and grow businesses that will power the state's economy well into the future. So perhaps the best part of Harrington Hub is that it will help students to develop a global worldview. These connections are the basis of international cooperation and diplomacy, building networks that both the cultural, intellectual, and economic exchange. So in closing, let me just say that the Harrington Hub, I believe, is an investment truly in our future, in our workforce, in our state, and as a nation as a whole. And for the students here today, let me just say that I'd like to reiterate that regardless of your path after URI, I know that communication skills will be invaluable. From business to public service or any other field, the skills learned at Harrington, I know, will serve you well for years to come. President Dooley, congratulations to you and to the university, and I look forward to the great contributions that Harrington will make well in the future. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Congressman Langevin. As always, your insightful comments, global impact.
I'm grateful to you, Congressman, for giving Congressman 680 a day pass.
It's been a pleasure to work with him, and since he joined his colleagues down in D.C. He's been a very, very strong advocate for education. He's been a very, very strong advocate for Rhode Island. He's been a very, very strong advocate for research. And Congressman Cicilline, in fact, was a leader in the effort in the House to ensure that federal funding for research that benefits the University of Rhode Island and indeed all educational institutions in Rhode Island was protected when, frankly, it was under threat. And for that, Congressman Cicilline, we will always be in your debt. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the podium.
Good morning. Thank you, President Dooley. I'm delighted to be here. Thank you, Jim, for your gracious hospitality in the 2nd Congressional District. I'm happy to be here first to say that I'm really proud to have joined a delegation led by Senator Reid, Senator Whitehouse, Congressman Langevin, that understands the value and the importance of higher education and the central role that it plays in the prosperity of our state and the future of our country, and the particularly important role that the University of Rhode Island plays. So I'm very proud to join a chorus of individuals who already were deeply committed to this university, and we work as a team and do all that we can to support URI. As Sheldon mentioned, a lot of great things are happening here, and that's due in large part to the extraordinary leadership of the President, President Dooley. So thank you for your visionary leadership and the energy that you've brought to this great university. I also want to thank Dick Harrington for his generous contribution to this effort, and Director Roth, thank you for your leadership. And thank you to everyone who has made this day possible. A special welcome to Meredith Vieira, who we claim as Providence, a Rhode Islander, someone who has never forgotten her home, and someone who has become such a distinguished journalist, but has never forgotten the role that her home state played in her life, and we are really grateful that you're and honored that you're with us today. This is a very exciting day for the university. It's a very exciting day for our state. This $6.2 million investment in this new hub is exactly the way that our state should be preparing to meet the educational needs of young people who come to the University of Rhode Island. This university is a premier public university, and the brand new Harrington Hub for Global Leadership in Communications and Media will help solidify its status as a leader in one of the cutting edge areas of our time, and one of the most fast changing, and one of the most consequential. The rapid growth of the internet and digital technologies has led to really unprecedented changes. And how all of us get our information, receive our news, watch our favorite shows, and interact with family and friends. This growth has tremendous opportunities for all of us to engage more closely, more deeply with each other, and with the rest of the world. But it also demands an entirely new set of skills and training for journalists and others who help us to navigate this new environment. Media professionals today have to be well-versed in every element of social media and technology, be able to compete for our attention, and to do it in a way that maintains the integrity of their work. The renovation of this historic Ranger Hall into a new state-of-the-art hub of Communications and Media symbolizes how this industry, like so many in our economy today, must continue to evolve and change as new technologies fundamentally change how we find and consume media and information in general. And so whether you're a student who is studying communications, film or media, journalism, public relations, writing, or library and information studies, this new center offers new facilities that will greatly enhance the quality of your education and your ability to interconnect and interact with this rapidly changing technology in our world. So this is a very exciting symbol of both what's happening in our great state, but what's happening at this great university, but also I think really a call to action as we train and think about the responsibility of journalists in the 21st century to understand that this work needs to be done using the most magnificent technology to reach the greatest number of people, but also to be guided by strong principles of integrity and truth so that we can share that and consume that information in a meaningful way. So congratulations to everyone who's part of this effort.
Thank you very much, Congressman Cicilline. I think previously, at one time or another, I have asked all of your colleagues for copies of remarks that they have made. Today, I would like to ask for a copy of the remark you just made, if you'd be so kind as to send them to me. I'd appreciate that. Adam, I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you, President Dooley, and Senators Jack Reed, Senators Sheldon Whitehouse, Congressman James Langevin, and Congressman David Cicilline. We will continue to work hard in graduating highly skilled communication and media professionals who we know will help lead Rhode Island into a digital future and also support the economic engine of this terrific state. And we know very well that in today's world, there's no organization on the planet any longer that is immune to the need for communication and media professionals. And so we feel great about the career potential of our students. We certainly could not do this project alone. And it comes along with infinite gratitude to a multitude of people who have helped get us here today. My wife is one of them, who reminded me as a nickname that I'm now called her Harrington Hubby. And so if you get a chance to meet my wonderfully intelligent and beautiful wife, Phoebe Roth, she's in the back. I hope you will get a chance to talk with her. I also thank our UI leadership team that took us through the design and construction of this project, from President David M. Dooley, and including Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs, Donald DeHaze, Vern Wyman, Assistant Vice President of Business Services, Paul DePace, Director of Capital Projects, and Kenny Burke, our project manager, one of the most competent and able individuals I've ever worked with in my entire professional career. I also thank Kip McMahon and Ryan Carrillo from Campus Planning and Design, our architects, Durkee, Brown, Viveros, and Warenfelds, our construction company, E.W. Berman, and all of the unions and workers that have been involved in the project, Tommy Hurst, the supervisor on the job, who I'm sure regrets every day that he gave me his cell phone number, and our audiovisual contractors, HB Communication. We also appreciate generous support for this event today from the President's Office, Provost's Office, Division of Administration and Finance, College of Arts and Sciences, URI Foundation, Office for International Education, all the members of the Harrington School community, its faculty, its staff, its students, and many alumni who have joined us, and especially the faculty, staff, and students who helped to plan this event, which was an amazing learning experience for them in public relations. I also appreciate the assistance of our Communications and External Relations Office, Kelly Mahoney, Linda Chardo, and Dave Lavallee and their colleagues, our Publications and Creative Services Office, Facilities, property services, dining services, office for university events, and my good friend Joanne Esposito, where we could just not do something like this without her. The farmer's daughter, who have donated the decorations for this event, and my dear friend and fellow board member, Mr. Mark Marositz, and his team at Worldways Social Marketing in Newport that spearheaded our recent PR campaign and built the entire microsite for this event and donated it to the Heritage School. Thank you, Mark. You are all helping to make sure that our reputation for international research and global communication projects is growing in awareness. So much so that it's even caught the attention of high-level officials in Washington who understand clearly the role communication plays in global relations, foreign policy, and international diplomacy. U.S. Assistant Secretary for Public Affairs and State Department spokesperson John Kirby is one of those individuals. Secretary Kirby had every intention of being with us here today, but alas, a last-minute high-profile dialogue kept him stuck in Washington, D.C. He did, however, send us this message, which he wishes to share with you from his office in Washington.
Good morning, everyone. I'm John Kirby, Assistant Secretary of State for Public Affairs. I'm very sorry that I can't be with you today. That had been my plan, and I was very much looking forward to it. The current events have kept me in the nation's capital. I wanted to take this opportunity to commend and congratulate all of you for the establishment at the University of Rhode Island of the Harrington Hub. This is going to be an important venue, an important tool, an important learning environment for us to get a better grasp on the nexus of international relations and communication technology. You know, Secretary Kerry says all the time that there shouldn't be anything foreign about foreign policy, that virtually everything that we do as a department and as a nation around the world affects the American people here at home, whether it's a trade deal or a climate agreement. Certainly the kinds of security assistance that we're helping allies and partners around the world with, particularly in the field of counterterrorism, all of that has a direct and daily impact on the American people. And the American people are themselves now changing the way they look at the world around them. And of course, how they look at events here at home. The citizen, the average citizen, is now more sovereign than they've ever been before. And part of the reason for that is because they have in their hands literally communication technology that allows them to stay plugged in and informed about the world around them instantly. It also allows them not just to consume information, but to share, disseminate, and to create information. There's a new word for it now called prosumers. People aren't just consuming news and information, they're helping produce it as well. Understanding that technology and how that affects their perception of the world around them and how they interact with the world around them is exactly what a place like the Harrington Hub can help us do better. So I'm very excited about what you're about to do here, about the task and the endeavor that you're taking on, and I urge you to continue to push the envelope, get chalk on your cleats, learn some, grow some, and help us all do a little bit better job of dealing with a very complicated, nuanced world of international relations and a fast, pace, ever-changing, very dynamic information environment that we're all living with, because they do come together in the phrase and words and deeds and actions of foreign policy. And so I'm very, very excited about what you're doing. I look forward very much to getting up there soon to see it for myself and to learn from you as you continue to learn about not just the world around us, but about the information environment that is informing and helping shape that world. So again, congratulations for this very important special day. Again, my apologies for not being with you. My very best to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary Kirby. So that we can live up to Secretary Kirby's expectations, I am delighted to announce for the first time some brand new funding opportunities that will support the success of our students and will be added to a large cadre of funding opportunities that we already supply to students in the Harrington School. The first is a gift that was given by Karen Adams, WPRI's former Emmy-winning anchor, who established a scholarship for women across all programs in the Harrington School to help them become a leader in communication, just as she became too. We also recently just received a gift from Pamela Farnsworth and Patricia Vance Opperman in honor of their parents, a scholarship for all students in the Harrington School. And just yesterday morning, we received an incredible gift from our partners at IGT, a gift that will support the continued expansion of our facilities in the Harrington Hub. And we ourselves are giving back, and this week we're proud to announce that we're launching a multimedia contest for high school students all across the state. And we are awarding a $2,000 tuition credit to students who are able to clearly articulate a vision of what the global future of communication and media will be once they graduate from the Harrington School. And more information about that scholarship is available at harrington.uri.edu/scholarships. We look forward to advertising this scholarship opportunity all across the state, and we'll be awarding it to a student entering into our next class next year. These scholarships and this building are truly an investment in our students. And inside the hub, you're gonna hear many success stories in videos that were made by our own students, and you'll see for yourself how well this investment is paying off. One of our students in particular has been selected today to represent her class and to share with you what this facility means to her. She's a student who excels in her coursework, who internalizes the global nature of communication and media, and who's been getting tremendous real-world experience in communication as a member of the Harrington School's media agency, which is supervised by our professor, Dr. Holly Smith. In the Harrington Media Agency, students run our entire social media campaign and the campaigns of organizations around the state. I'm delighted to welcome Miss Letitia Simone, a public relations major and graduating class of 2017.
Good morning, everyone. As a Harrington School student and a public relations major, I'm honored to have the opportunity to speak to you all today. Of course, the focus of today is the Harrington Hub for Global Leadership in Communication and Media. And as many have said before me, globalization is so important in today's world. When I was 3 years old, my mother and I moved from Brazil to the United States. And 18 years have passed since then, and I have just learned that it is so essential to realize how big our world is. This is what gives me such a strong appreciation for the global focus of the Harrington School. Being a public relations major here has given me so many opportunities through their various resources. I think that our greatest resource here are our professors. Our professors go above and beyond to make sure that we know everything that there is to know before we leave this university. And this year, the focus has been on globalization, communication, and media. Communication and media play such a vital part in our world. Harrington School students have been given the opportunity to learn how to become effective communicators in this 21st century. 7 months from now, which is really scary, when I leave here, I know that I will be ready to enter the job market. I will graduate from the Harrington School well-networked, and I will have practical and theoretical experiences that will help me make the Harrington School proud. I wish I had more than 2 minutes to tell you guys about everything that the Harrington School has taught me, but unfortunately I do not. But I can tell you that the Harrington School has helped me become a better public speaker, as well as learn how to write on various platforms like I do at the agency, and learn how to adapt to different audiences. These are all relevant skills that the Harrington School adapts every single day to make sure that we know what we're doing and keeping up with our contemporary society and ever-changing media. As Dr. Ross said, this school offers so many possibilities for their students, and the Harrington Hub is just one of the ways we are achieving that. The Harrington Hub, along with the Harrington School, are the stepping stones for myself and many other students to become global leaders. I'm very excited to step foot into the Harrington Hub and hope as you walk through it today, you will see the possibilities that I see as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Leticia, for epitomizing the spirit, the intellectual curiosity, and the determination to succeed that we attempt to instill in all of our students in the Harrington School. And Leticia's story of growing up abroad and bringing her international experiences into the classrooms at URI is unique, although in many ways it also represents the radical diversity and global reach of our entire community. Our award-winning faculty who present their research and films all around the world, and many of them who have joined us from other countries around the world. Our graduate students who come to us from China and India and Mexico and Africa. And our incredible undergraduate students who study in over 50 countries around the world so they can see firsthand what the concept of intercultural communication means. One of our students in particular developed a video highlighting the global reach of the Harrington School, which I would like to share with you today.
Being from Germany, I have had a different approach to environmental transportation compared to here. So I think I've been able to bring some of the learning to the hands.
My global research and teaching focuses on digital literacy and also global education.
I'm from Sarajevo, Bosnia-Herzegovina, and my film work concerns conflict zones. My documentaries have been broadcast on Al Jazeera, and my fiction films have been honored at the Academy Awards.
I have a focus on experiential learning and global issues, which I integrate into the courses I teach.
My global nature of research focuses on the intercultural communication, especially for the intercultural adaptation.
Hola, mi nombre es Emmy-winning TV. I'm from Mexico, and I'm very proud to say that I graduated from the Master Communication Studies program from URI.
Never in my wildest dreams would I have thought that I'd be in China teaching in a major university and making an impact on students, both Chinese and international.
Students come in seeking to study abroad to kind of grow their own experiences the same way I have grown my study abroad.
I was in Florence last spring semester, and it was probably my favorite semester that I've had. Every day was a new adventure. You woke up and walked out of the apartment in this beautiful city full of history and culture, and you never really knew what to expect.
I was given the opportunity to study abroad with you. It was just an amazing experience being able to indulge in the culture, and the experience was just life-changing.
Well, this summer, I was lucky enough to go to San Lucas, Spain for a month for a Spanish program. I got to see a lot of Spain all in a month. And I earned credit for it, which was amazing.
I went last summer for 3 weeks, where I studied abroad in Salzburg, Austria. My experience is very difficult to put into words because it was so life-changing, and that sounds so cliche, but those were the best 3 weeks of my life.
I'm from Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. I did a project which was part of an internship with Edizia Global Nutrition. We were able to put together an entire social media campaign.
I'm very excited that the Harrington School is including the global aspect of communication.
This school has taught me a great deal when it comes to international communication. It's a great experience.
to see the world from a different perspective is so key to your personal life and your professional life. No matter where you end up, it's something you can always use to your advantage.
No. Buwa bara buru-buru. Manaino ko. Aya na wizi bita. In Igbo, in Nigeria, that means welcome. The world may be big and global, but when we come together, we can do a lot.
This is my dream job, so thank you, URI.
Talk about talented filmmakers. So while we're a global player now, though, when I came to URI 10 years ago, the Harrington School was mainly a concept. It was a possibility, a vision, and a dream. But the person who sold me on that vision was Dean Winnie Brownell. I knew after interviewing and speaking with her that I wanted to be here at URI to help build this school of communication and media. And Dean Brownell is largely responsible for making that vision and dream become a reality. And I'd like to introduce you to my boss and my mentor, Dr. Winnie Brownell.
Thank you. Isn't he terrific? I should point out today is Adam Roth's birthday. Wow. Dreams really do come true. I feel like we made it over the rainbow. There's no place like URI. We are so delighted to see so many of our URI leaders, in addition to President David M. Dooley, Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs Donald DeHaze is here, Vice President for Research and Economic Development Jerry Sonnenfeld is here, the dynamic duo taking care of administration and finance, Vern Wyman and Linda Barrett are here, and I want to thank my colleague deans who could make it, Dean Brigida, Ibrahimpour, Kirby, our John Kirby, that is, Dean Jane Richmond, Dean Wolf, Dean Zawiya, and also I thought I saw Thor Bjorn there. I can't see over many heads, but I can usually find Thor, our director of athletics. The journey to today began, as Adam pointed out, several years ago. I still remember, and I'm so grateful for that introduction that President Robert L. Carruthers, who is here today, made by bringing together Dick Harrington and folks in the Harrington School. I remember that day where he came and he saw our students and faculty and started talking about the possibilities of what we could do with that grand old quadrangle building, Ranger. And I really appreciate the role the president and our current president both played in making that idea become a reality. We obviously needed the help of so many. Not one or two people really have developed the Harrington School to where it is today and even made this building transformation possible. Conceiving and building and launching took so many. Obviously, our founding director, Renee Hobbs, our current director, Adam Roth, incredible, incredible professionals on our advisory board. They're a dream team of talent in communication and media. We also appreciated our whole array of department and program heads who were there every single day, our talented faculty, our wonderful students, including our amazingly energetic Harrington Rangers, and our unbelievably supportive staff who all worked together to make this possible. I'd like to also thank Assistant Dean Tom Zorabedian, who works every day for the Harrington School, and our associate deans, Trish Morikoff and Nancy Eaton, who have been there also problem solving, troubleshooting, and paving the way for all of these possibilities. I really, really appreciate Adam Roth's vigilance and dedication watching this building project every step of the way. As you know, those of you involved in major construction, things can happen. And Adam was there along with our amazing building committee every step of the way in the construction team to make sure that everything went well. But the most visionary leader who has inspired me every single day is Richard J. Harrington. I am so grateful for his leadership, his wisdom, his creativity, And of course, along with his beautiful wife, Jean, their transformative gift that made the Harrington School possible. Every time I have the opportunity to talk to Dick, I learn something new, something important, something of value. I feel like I've already earned a bachelor's in Richard J. Harrington strategic thinking, and I'm eternally grateful for that. I am so in awe of everything he's done as a professional. He's chairman and general partner of Cue Ball. He set the overall strategic direction in helping people really achieve their goals in his role. He was CEO of Thomson and brokered that amazing deal with Thomson Reuters. And he took that company through phenomenal transformations in terms of adding value and brokering billions of dollars of deals to make it the communication and media giant that it is today. And it's wonderful that he's reaching out in his role as Cue Ball to help others achieve those kinds of dreams. He received a Leader of the Year award from Yale University, Leader and CEO of the Year. He also, in addition to his bachelor's in business administration from URI, he received an honorary degree in recognition of his phenomenal talents. Please help me give a warm, roady welcome home to the most brilliant strategic advisor, visionary, and best friend of the Harrington School of Communication and Media, Dick Harrington.
Thank you very much, Winnie. Very kind words. I paid her a lot of money for that. That's why she's retiring early. Does Adam have enough energy, you think, or do we need to take some of the pills that he takes? I would like Jean to stand up because. I only sign half the checks. My wife signs the other half. So I wouldn't be up here today if it wasn't for her. I really want to thank Winnie when we started this project in 2009, President Dooley and Provost Don DeHaze, because during that process, from when we started to where we are today, they helped us out with additional fundings. You know, we might have had some disagreements on how to make some things happen. As President Dooley said, I come from a different world where things don't move quite as slow, and so it took me a while to adjust, but you'll be happy to know I finally adjusted, and I feel extremely proud and happy about what's happening at the Harrington School, and more importantly, the school today. But without their support, they've helped us add some staff and funded some other positions that we desperately needed to help us where we got today. I also want to thank Renee Hobbs, who was our first director. Renee was very good and got us going and had some great ideas to move the school forward. Dr. Bob Carruthers, who I'll politely say encouraged Jean and me to make an investment in the school with Winnie at his side all the time. And it took us a while to get there, but we did get there reasonably quickly. And especially want to thank Adam, because of the hard work he's done since he's been the director of the school, awful lot of progress is made, and I really appreciate everything you've done. And as Adam said and others said earlier, you know, we don't get there without the faculty and the staff and the students. They're the ones that make this school tick, and without them, I don't think we'd be here today. So it's critical that the core professors, that teacher, and everyone who works with these students and the students themselves, without them, we are nothing. And they're the ones that make the Harrington schools successful. And most importantly, they're the ones who basically demonstrate it every single day. As we saw all the different, as you said, all the students worked on all the media for this particular program. Now, the new facility is a dream come true. We've been working on it a while. Someone asked me one time why it took so long, and it didn't take a long time because of the school, because of the way the school operates. We actually had other tenants in there first. We I had to move the other tenants out, and then we had to do the design, and then we had to put the bids out for contracts, and then we had to raise the money, and then we had to get it done. So it actually was done on a reasonably timely basis, considering everything that had to be accomplished. And by the way, it's an extremely important milestone for the school because it really sets the stage, as we all know, having a building, especially on the quadrangle. I'm actually catching up to the age of the building, which is probably not a good sign, but to have it, and I did take a walk in earlier to see it, and it really looks beautiful, so I obviously encourage all of you to go in and visit the school. And as Provost Don DeHay said, we have to start working on 2, 3, and 4 as quickly as possible. Now, I want to just tell you a little story how the journey began. Once we made the decision, or once Jeannie and I made the decision to fund the Harrington School, which is kind of comical because I didn't really want it named after me. It didn't really, wasn't necessary, but they told me, but I was told you have to put your name on it because we need a name on the school. When Winnie and I sat down, and we did not have a director at the time, so it was just Winnie and I, and so when we sat down to really discuss what do we do next, well, we said, let's do some research to really determine as the school evolves, the curriculum will evolve because we have to match it to what's going on in the communication world today. And obviously to do that, we should probably do some research because if you all live in kind of Kingston, Rhode Island in the school, but it's important we reach out to businesses and other government and other professionals to see what do they think the needs of communication and media are today. So we were trying to decide how to do that, so I suggested to Winnie, why don't we have a class? Students are free, they get a grade, they've already paid, they're actually paying to do this, so why don't we put a class together to do it? And it wasn't on the curriculum, it wasn't scheduled, didn't have a space to do it, so Winnie said, well, we didn't have a professor, so Winnie said she would do the class, which she did. We did it out of her office. And we found, I think, 3 graduate students and 3 undergrad students that were the top students in the school that thought this was really something great to do. And we had them call up, we gave them a script, et cetera, and they called up a number of different businesses and organizations throughout Rhode Island and outside Rhode Island just to interview so we can get some feedback. I actually had a call during that time from a friend of mine who's in Rhode Island who happens to be in the public relations business. And basically said, I had this call from the University of Rhode Island from the Harrington School. I figured you must have had something to do with that. So, but the important thing is so they did the research for us, but to make sure it was important, we invited President Dewey to come to the final day of class presentations. Now, just before that, the biggest issue we had is when the first day of class, I'm not sure if I made the first day, but maybe it was the second day of class where I phoned in. And they got Winnie a brand new speakerphone. Winnie didn't have a clue how to use it. So she still doesn't, as Adam says. But the most important thing is to stress the importance of that class. President Dooley was kind enough to come for the presentations. And by the way, the students did an outstanding job putting their research together and telling us what they learned. So what I said to Winnie, we really have to, do something for them. So we told them beforehand that after we did the presentation, we'll take them out to lunch. So the president, I don't think, could come with us that day because he had other responsibilities, obviously. But Winnie and I took these 6 students out to a very nice restaurant. We had a champagne toast for what they were doing, and they had a very nice meal funded by me. The school didn't have to pay for it. We had a very nice meal. And more importantly, they all got an A in the class, right? We thought, first of all, they all did an outstanding job. They worked extremely hard, but we thought that was critical that they got an A. But I just didn't remember that when I was here. I don't think any professor took me out for a champagne brunch and a class. But to get serious, Jean and I made this made the initial gift because we really saw an opportunity for the University of Rhode Island to build a communication school for the 21st century. I was in the B2B information world. I've seen it go from print to electronic, but obviously it went from software services. And just to give you a little some sizing scale what happened in my 11 years as CEO of Thomson and now Thomson Reuters. When I started, we had some technology people, but they were mostly for typesetting or printing, et cetera. By the time I left, we had 12,000 technology people working for us, not only dealing with the large databases and manipulating large databases, but also doing all the applications and the tools and the methodologies to basically build products and services for our customers. So that was an 11-year period. Our organization completely changed during that time. And when we had editors, when I first started, they were really database people. They built databases that were utilized. And the only reason we even had print products is because a few people bought them and we made money at it. But the important thing is that we had an opportunity to really provide the University of Rhode Island with a communication school that can be a second to none. Most communication schools, and to a degree like URI, were siloed. You had journalism or rhetoric or public relations, et cetera. And this was an opportunity over time to really change the landscape of how not only do we learn about communications, but then how do we deliver it? And the reason why I say this wasn't about not teaching skills in journalism and not teaching rhetoric and not teaching the skills. Those skills were needed. The question is, how are we going to use them in the future, which as we all found out, is a lot different than we've used them in the past. And let's face it, you know, we can do anything with this device today. We can so when we see it on, you know, we see it on broadcast TV or news, et cetera. Every single event is filmed, whether we know it or not. And we see it, and we see how the social media, and even broadcast media and cable media, we see the chaotic nature it can come when you just look at this election. When you look at everything that's out there in this election, it's really just amazing. But the most important thing is that I happen to think that basically there'll be more jobs in this field than any other field going forward. I think the hard sciences are critical. We need the chemistry. We need STEM, and we should continue to drive STEM. But at the same time, since everybody can express themselves anytime they want, it's critical that we actually learn how to do that properly. And civilly, if we want a society that we all would want to live in. And then I think from a job point of view, every single industry, every single company, every single organization, profit, nonprofit, large, small, has to understand how to communicate, whether it's with customers or whether they're constituents, et cetera, have to understand how to do that strategically and what particular methodology are they going to use, or they will need people to help them do it. And so there's a radical transformation going on. There's one that's gone on. It's still going to go on for a while, and it's critical that the University of Rhode Island is at the top of that transformation in teaching and helping those students learn how to deal with not only today, but how to continue to grow and develop. Jeannie and I are very happy to know that the students from around the world will be learning the right way to communicate at the University of Rhode Island and at the Harrington School going forward. And most importantly, that they'll learn how to harness that the power of that communication and to do great things in the world with it that we can all be proud of. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dick, for your leadership gift, for your support, for your vision, and also for your friendship. And last year, I sent Dick a present. I sent him a brand new jacket, embroidered Harrington School, and I asked him 6 months later, I said, "What do you think of the jacket, Dick? Have you been wearing it?" He said, "Well, it's too small. You know, you need a larger one." So in acknowledgement of your commitment to our success and of everything you have done to help us build this global school of communication and media, I present you with our key to the city, a larger size embroidered Harrington School jacket that should fit well. Wow. In just a minute, I'm going to ask you to join me over at Ranger Hall, where we're going to be doing a ceremonial film cutting on our new facility, followed by a feast of foods from around the globe and tours of our new facility. So we can't wait to show you it. And to lead us in to this ribbon cutting ceremony, this film cutting ceremony, we've asked our URI percussion ensemble to join us today. And not just to drum up excitement for the event, but also to remember that drumming is one of the most universal and primordial forms of communication known to all civilizations on the planet. So is our URI ensemble still here? All right, lead us in, and thank you all for being here today.